Well, greetings everybody, and welcome to yet another adventure in the Talking Head show, where we call the Inworld Review. Yes, indeed, Talking Heads every week on the DOS. And this is, what we discuss is news and discussion topics from the metaverse. And for those of you who don't know, the metaverse is the world of immersive spaces. Some of them you can experience in all these newfangled toys for VR, otherwise known as virtual reality, of course. But the worlds we are engaged with tend to be sort of living entities, places for collaboration, communication, entertainment, where your avatar is actually represents yourself, so to speak, and every other avatar represents another real person doing serious or less than serious stuff, but certainly way beyond the concept of a simple game. Right, that's my blurb for the week on that front. It is the 31st of January. Believe it or not, it's not only the last Sunday, it's the last day of January 2016. So next week's show will be over in Second Life, that old granddaddy of a platform, and where we do the first show of every month. Hard to believe we're already in February. It seems like just yesterday when all the New Year shenanigans were going on. But there we are. There we are. We're on the doorstep of February, shall I say. Anyway, before we carry on, just going to introduce you to the folks we got here today. I'm Mal Burns, of course. Next to me, on my right, as I'm looking at it anyway, we've got Maria Karloff from Hypergrid Business, my regular co-host. So welcome, Maria.
Hey, Mal. Thanks for having me. Always a pleasure.
And next to Maria, we've got James Abloud, who is, of course, our wonderful cameraman who manages to film and stream this to you every week, but is also, what's the expression, a dab hand at the useful questions in the conversations. So he's on the panel too. So welcome, James.
Well, thanks, Mal. I think of myself as color commentary, but maybe that doesn't apply. Looking forward to Maria's report on VR gadgets this week, headsets and such. Should be fun.
Indeed, indeed, they come flying at us. And also with us today, she has been on the show several times before, so you probably know her already. Her name is Leslie Kling, and she's from Tangle Grid. So welcome, Leslie.
Welcome. Thank you very much for having me again. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Yeah. And there's quite a lot going on, TangleGrid, which we'll get round to after we sort of covered the basic news, including a brand new hunt, which is uses the same display system as the one I've got on the station next door here, which has been here since the last hunt. But we'll be talking about that later. And maybe this time I can figure out a way to res it properly myself, as I think I goofed on the last one. Well, I know I did because you just checked. Anyway, on with the show, so to speak. I'm just going to read out a few of the headlines I've got up here in our news feeds. Most of them come, if I don't give you direct links, you can find the links to the articles via my Twitter feed at twitter.com/MalBurns or one word. I have another media stream as well, but I'll give you that later if there's time. But the main feed there is on general metaverse stuff. And it also includes Mr. Maria's posts. So I'll be skipping over them to leave them to her as the time comes. Okay, I'm going back to January 24th, which I think the two posts here were actually put up after last week's show, so I'll just mention them. A company called Starbreeze Studios have opened a VR arcade venue to showcase Star VR headset. This is just a link that goes to Twitter, so I can't tell you which site it was on. It may have been Rode VR, I'm not sure. I remember looking at this Star VR headset and thinking, well, it looks like every other one I've seen, except it's a damn sight louder. It had black and white sort of graphics all over it, so it's not, you know, instead of just a black box on your head, it's
It actually has a significant difference from other headsets. Instead, normally with headsets, you get it uses one cell phone screen, and then it uses it splits up the image into two halves, and you have two lenses kind of expanding those two halves to fill your field of view.
Yeah.
And the field of view on the high-end headsets are between 90 and 110 degrees. So that's where your Oculus is going to fall in, your Gear VR, and so forth.
Right.
The Starbreeze has two separate displays, and they claim their field of view is 210 degrees.
Oh.
Now, the question is, do you really need a 210-degree field of view? Because I was playing around with my Gear VR a lot lately this past week, writing some articles for other publications. And there were times when you couldn't even see the edge of the screen because of the way it was, you know, the image was set up. And I'm like, you know, this is already 96 degrees. I mean, I do have a nice cell phone with it, the Samsung Galaxy, which is a pretty big screen. But still, you know, how much bigger do you know you're really going to get?
I mean, if you glimpse
up and down a little bit more.
Yeah, I mean, if you glimpse out the corner of your eyes, you know, there's a limit to how far you can go. Otherwise, you're just doing what you do in real life, which is turning your head, you know. So.
Exactly. So I don't think we need to go all the way to 210, but I think if we get up to like 130, 150, we're well there. And having this giant thing with two display screens on your face could be a little bit of overkill. But then on the other hand, if you have a very adventure game-ish kind of experience with people shooting at you and it's all in your peripheral vision, then maybe it makes sense.
Yeah. A use case for everything, maybe. Yeah.
We'll see. We'll see how well it does once it's open.
I presume that extra field of view is probably down to the calibration of two separate images rather than two side-by-side images, which don't actually vary that much as a rule. I'd be quite curious. It must be...
You've got twice the screen space.
Exactly.
Again, a separate screen for each eye. So instead of having... 100 degrees total for both eyes, you've got 100 degrees for each eye. So, yeah, it's going to cover much, much more of your face.
I pity anybody who suffers from double vision. You can imagine wearing one of these things if you've already got vision where, you know, you see two of everything. You'll just see four now. Great fun. Anyway.
Yeah, there's a percentage of the population that can't see 3D, or so I've been told, so.
Interesting. I mean, it's a bit like color blindness, I suppose. I mean, I don't know, you know, but I'm slightly color blind. I think it's in reds and browns.
Yeah.
But I see what I see. And, you know, I once had a sort of boss just doing something temporarily. He decided he didn't want me to do it because I'd been to a medical exam and they discovered I was color blind. At the same time, he himself said he'd always admire my taste in color. You know, so when he... What the hell, you know, you can only with your own perception, you know, but so maybe I do good color matching because I can't see some of the mystery colors further beyond my ken. Anyway, beside the point. So yes, you know, I'm sure people would just jump into virtual reality 24 hours a day, a minority, and others won't touch it with a barge pole, and all points in between, really. It's the way we go. Okay, another link, the Abbott's book. It wants to be the gothic mist of virtual reality, but can it pull it off? Another article, again, from my feed. This sounds quite interesting, simply because I've never really been a gamer. I'm always shot down in the first frame. But the exceptions to that were I loved playing two games on... actually, it was on a CDI machine I used to play them, but they were on the Mac too. One was called Seventh Guest, which is full of puzzles in a haunted house, and the other one was Mist. And the Mist referred to be the gothic Mist of virtual reality in this title is MYST after the legendary Mist game, which really was lovely. It still influences the hobbyist sort of building I'm doing here in the Canada grid at the moment, you know, just a sort of empty place to explore, basically. Yes, maybe that'd be a good item. Right, moving on to the beginning of the week, the proper beginning of the week. First post, of course, is a post about last week's show. The Virtual Education Journal, VEJ, for January 2016, was published at the beginning of the week. It's on an online distribution platform called Issue, ISSUU. But I leave Twitter, my link on Twitter, I believe, contains an embed code so you can watch it direct from the Twitter. Sorry, read it, is the expression we need there, direct from the Twitter feed. And they also published a new one called Virtual Reality. It was a prototype issue that I got yesterday. I didn't link to it because it's full of blank pages that are just mock-ups. Although they did have some of the articles in them. And they are focusing on education experiences using virtual reality, and a particular focus was on Minecraft, OpenSim, Second Life, and interestingly, quite a lot on high fidelity. But as I say, it was a half-completed beta issue, so I didn't actually post it, but it looks like it could be an interesting read when it comes out. Right, my next link just says bot. That's very helpful, isn't it? It obviously tweeted something and didn't get the title. Right, now, I don't want to prolong conversation on this, but there was an article, Firestorm Lead Recommends Alchemy Viewer for OpenSim. This, I believe, was one that went to Maria's blog, but there have actually been several other things on this, and I had an exchange with Jessica Leon during the week because she was on the show about 3 weeks ago. And if you listen to the show, it's very interesting. We're a bit sad in some ways about wondering how Firestorm would keep up with OpenSim. But she basically said that, you know, the all their devs are Second Life, and Second Life is their main audience. But I think she gave the impression to some people that they really weren't interested in OpenSim, and that's actually far from the case. And since that show about 3 weeks ago, there have been places like the Great Canadian Grid here who have actively started Firestorm users groups with the specific intention of giving the Firestorm devs feedback as far as OpenSim and the hypergrid is concerned. So,
well, that's fantastic. I'm so happy for that because it's my favorite viewer.
Yeah, I'm mine too.
Mine too.
It's the issue here really is simply that, you know, the majority of Firestorm's user base are using it in Second Life. And, you know, given their whole user base, a minority are using it for OpenSim. And so obviously they have to go focus on where their main customers are. And as Linden Lab are diverging from the traditional setup with Second Life, so too is OpenSim increasingly diverging from the system of Linden Labs. So at some point, it's quite obvious you need a separate viewer for, you know, for the hypergrid and another one that you would use for a closed platform like Second Life. Firestorm themselves are very keen on both. And Jessica Lyon, of course, lives right next door to Roddy, who runs the Great Canadian Grid here. And she herself is very keen on OpenSim. But the majority of her devs at the moment are concerned with Second Life. And so the more OpenSim developers and co-writers and things can keep Firestorm appraised of what is going on, the more they can get that code into an OpenSim version. So it's really all down to communication at the end of the day. And one of my later links down the list here is actually that Jessica did write a blog on the Firestorm site. Just explaining their position because she got lots of IMs from people. You know, oddly enough, it wasn't after our show. It's been in the subsequent week or 10 days. People complaining, oh, you know, we don't want Firestorm to go. And, you know, she's doing her best to say we're not going anywhere if we can help it, is the gist of it. So cough up the collaboration, folks, and we'll all be okay.
I noticed that there's a lot of discussion on my article about it as well, and yeah. I also saw that on your YouTube channel, the audience for it was like 3-4 times higher than that of any other show. So people went back to watch that episode.
Yeah, I did. I had, I mean, you had your article, of course, which I must admit complained about. But we won't go into that. But there were quite a few other posts, too, that were latching onto the thing that maybe OpenSim, you know. And they actually, the other articles actually embedded a copy of our show so you could go back and rewind and watch it.
Yeah.
So
everyone got really upset at my article, and there were a lot of reactions posted.
Yeah, but yeah. I think the hits on the show actually came not in the week following the show, but in this case we got a lot of hits last week because of the because of that particular discussion.
Discussions, so, yeah.
Good for our show, I guess. Good for. Apart from the bit of controversy, I went on Hypergrid Safari on Thursday. The first thing Thursday said to me, I said, "I see you're stirring up trouble in the women of the Hypergrid again." I just laughed. She was being flippant, but yeah.
Yeah. When everything like started exploding, I was like really really busy at my day job, so I didn't have time to respond. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, I was like, "Well, you know, people can go to the videotape anyway." And so she responded in the comments, and other people responded in their posts. So it turned into a really live discussion of an issue that needed to be discussed.
Well, absolutely. I mean,
yeah, and previously it had been. I mean, she'd brought this up before on other shows and in other stories I've written, and it never really went anywhere. You know. And this is a big issue, and it's been discussed at community conferences as well and other places. Mm. And people said, oh, yeah, it would be nice to have more communication. And then that was it, you know, yeah. It kind of like ended there.
That is
so
the
I'm really glad that people kind of got worked up about it enough to do something about it.
Yeah, no, that's always a good sign, you know, that sort of, you know, if we triggered discussion, then all the merrier, really. And yes, as I say, I mean, you know, I think it's safe to say that users, by which I mean residents of virtual worlds who Hypergrid around or not, as the case may be, and hang out, Firestorm is by far the most popular viewer. On yes. OpenSim, people use Alchemy, they use Kalkua, they use Singularity, and all sorts of other things for, you know, builders, machinima makers, things to do particular tasks often have a preferred viewer. There isn't Firestorm, but the vast majority of people, you know, Firestorm is such a wonderful viewer that, you know, it's got this very loyal following, and understandably people got a bit nervous. So it's great all that's being sorted out and being made clear. Now, talking about code and contributions and stuff like that, DigiWorlds, Terry Ford's grid, well, it's not just Terry, but closely related, in fact, to Canada here. DigiWorlds tends to beta test everything that's in Canada. They've donated the code for a mumble voice system to the OpenSim core. Now, it is actually unfinished code. But for somebody who knows what they're doing, it may not be a great deal of work to implement this. And Mumble is basically a voice system that's an alternative to VVox. And if a grid was running Mumble, I gather that once you teleported to that grid, the viewer would switch automatically to Mumble, just thinking it was VVox. But it is unfinished code, so they've just sort of donated it to the pool so that anybody who can come up with workarounds on it can do so. More advanced publicity this week for the 9th annual Virtual World's Best Practices in Education conference, which will be happening in March. The links are in my feed. Virtuality pioneer Noni de la Pena, I presume that's the right pronunciation, charts the future of VR journalism. Again, I'm reading from a new list this week, and for some reason it shows me my Twitter link and a shortcode link, and it doesn't tell me where half these articles are. I'm pretty sure that this was Voices of VR, or certainly reposted at Rhodes VR. And a link to something called Pleasurecraft as well. I think that was some kind of VR prototype. Right. Now, the biggest thing that I can see this week in the blogs is that this week was the week when the Sundance Film Festival happened. And you only have to read blogs that deal with film festivals and things to realize that the whole darn festival seemed to have been taken over by VR, or rather VR film. There are apparently just an astonishing number of submissions to the film festival that had either used VR for filming, not all like cinema, but actual sort of techniques where actors were made to act in VR rather than as avatars, mixed reality emerging, a whole lot of things going on. So again, Sundance Festival launched VR app powered by IM360. Basically, this is a 3D app you could download onto your mobile device, especially if you were attending the conference or the festival, I should say, and keep following everything in 360. Alumet is a VR film which evokes character presence in a beautiful virtual world. I don't know what this stood up like from a storytelling point of view, but from a visual point of view, it's certainly wowed everybody who saw it. And if this is the one I think it is, where I saw some screenshots, there was some very seamless mixing of real avatars with what was completely was obviously a virtual reality generated backgrounds, but where the uncanny valley thing where you could barely tell the difference, and it was described as beautiful. So there you go. Okay, various other things here, and I'm sorry if I'm hijacking. I'm just summarizing anyway. I may be hijacking some areas here because, believe it or not, I can't tell which ones lead to Hypergrid Business anymore. It's in my brand new feed. It's very convenient, but it doesn't tell me where they go. Why brands are racing to pick a virtual reality partner (brackets) and how to pick a good one. I'm pretty sure that was Rhodes VR, but I can't be too sure. The complexity of virtual worlds reign at the VR LA Winter Expo. VR LA is Virtual Reality Los Angeles, and they had an expo there, and that was really a comment on the complexity of different aspects of virtual reality that we're showing there. For those following the medical stuff, a man managed to survive, believe it or not, 48 straight hours in VR with no reported nausea. I suspect that would depend on what kind of VR it is, what kind of device you're using to go in there, and how many straws people stick in your mouth to feed you during those 48 hours. But anyway, no apparent nausea on that one. And as I said, there is a link here to the Firestorm Viewer. It was a sort of off-center blog from Jessica. Open letter to OpenSim Firestorm Viewer, giving a response to people's worries on that point and putting them to rest, I think. How meditation placebos and virtual reality help power, inverted commas, mind over body. Basically, this is another sort of thing with the medical slant, although possibly more of a psychological one as well. Likening to how meditation can affect healing processes, placebos that aren't really the drugs they pretend to be, often psychologically heal people, even though they contain nothing. And they were discussing virtual reality as helping in these matters in that context. A retweet from Leap Motion, @LeapMotion on Twitter, designing VR tools They had a whole little article on designing tools for virtual reality, not just their only motion product, which is getting a lot of more traction now as a possible input device for VR. How IRL love can survive in the age of VR? IRL, it presumably stands for in real life. And how can it survive in the age of VR? There are, needless to say, I don't know whether it's love or lust or some other kind of passion. There are lots of devices coming along, along with programs in VR that tap into everything from dating, emotional relationships, through to just or sex, basically. And
there's been objects like that in Second Life for quite some time. I remember at least 2 or 3 years ago, there was a USB port plug-in apparatus that was linked into SL, and every time you get stimulated through those things, it would activate.
I think anything could be done these days. Actually, there is one of these articles, I don't know whether it's this particular one, had a, well, I think I've seen the photo before. It's a classic photo of probably the man on top of the woman, you know, naked, although we probably didn't see any of that, both wearing Oculus headsets. And you know, you look at it and think, why?
Very romantic, that is.
Yes,
it's like wearing your socks and your boots, ain't it?
Well, I think it might be a bit worse than wearing socks and boots, to be honest. But yes, exactly. You know, you look at a poster like that and you think, oh, yeah, but right, I'm going to do that, you know. But of course, there are, I'm still trying to find out what happened to the Australian underwear company. That had internet connected underwear, but they've made a big splash, but they seem to have disappeared now, so maybe they're still selling, I don't know. Right, life, the universe, and virtual reality. The South Bank unveils a classical season. The South Bank is referring to the London South Bank here, which is where the Royal Festival Hall and venues are, and they are having a whole season of classical concerts, which, as well as going to the South Bank to see them, you'll be able to strap on VR headsets and see enhanced aspects of the performance in virtual reality while you're listening. Nice stuff. That I doubt if I'll go, but you know, good to see that outside venue type use of virtual reality beginning to get some traction. Which we always, I remember I discussed here with Maria quite a lot. We always thought that would be the first big area where, you know, these things will get traction, because sure, there's going to be gamers buying Oculus helmets, but you know, the idea of sort of cinemas or venues opening up where you take a seat and you sit in, you know, a headset, a bit like a woman, you know, a hairdryer and a hair salon, and you know, just experience events that way, an out of home experience, I think is really the only final avenue for some of these big, more cumbersome contraptions. My thoughts there, however. Also, the best budget-friendly virtual reality headsets for smartphones. A review article there, just looking at the best budget-friendly things like cardboard and cardboard variants and more cardboard variants, mostly. Right, January 29th, Unicorn VR. Provide a nice introduction to VR. I can't remember that one, so I'll pass on this. Another one I think I must go to, Maria, Avi Labs hosting.
Yes.
And a similar article to go with it, Avi Labs expands hosting offerings. User-created content is key to mainstream VR. A second Indian phone has come bundled with a VR headset. There are two mates of phone in India, the Indian subcontinent, that is, that actually sell with ready-made bundle with a VR headset. Over at Google, where they do the cardboard contraption, 5 million cardboard shipped, 25 million VR apps played. The latest stats from Google on that front. Now, the other big thing that has happened during the latter half of the week, and we have it, we've actually talked about it a number of times on this show, is the fact that Apple Computer have seemingly not been, at least generally seen to be in the play with VR and stuff. But Tim Cook emerged this week. A main article, I believe the originating article was with the Financial Times. Firstly, we had Tim Cook saying that VR is not a niche, proving that he was quite into it. And also the fact that Apple has been doing a lot of hiring and indeed buying up companies during the course of this week, which would suggest that they are doing quite a lot. And in fact, the Financial Times did have, it will be further down the list here, but an article saying along the lines of Apple has secret team working on secret VR product. So it seems that, although we don't know what, and we never do with Apple, it does seem that they're the word is going around that this is not an area they are neglecting. So we shall see what we see.
This will be time for a great double take of some sort, or a what?
Yeah, as if they're going to miss the boat. But,
right.
I mean, some of the articles have actually printed the specifications for one of their patents, which is a full VR viewing device, which actually doesn't seem any more cumbersome than Google Glass. And, you know, that would be typical Apple to me if they came out with a product which is like the, you know, glasses I've always been talking about, you know, no plugging cell phones into cardboard, just put on a pair of glasses like sunshades. Yep. And you're there.
Yep.
You know, if any company is going to come left at center with something like that, it's probably Apple. So yeah, it'll be elegant, and it will come in 25 layers of packaging to keep you in awe while you unwrap the parcel, you know. Yep. Apple know how to do that kind of thing. Something I got from Apple recently, it wasn't the iPad Pro, it was something. Oh, it's the Apple
TV.
The Apple TV.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was a challenge to open. You know, it wasn't one of these horrible things with like sealed plastic where you have to find a pair of scissors, if not shears, to actually cut the thing open. It wasn't anything like that. It was just little bits and bits, you know, to fit everything into place and the packaging. It took a long while to get the darn thing open, but, you know, while you're doing it, the tension is kind of building, you know, you're just waiting to see what's inside under all this wrapping.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, fun stuff. Right, Game On. I can't remember what that link is all about. Game On. Unless that's something Maria will know about, I'm not quite sure, but it's in my links anyway. Meanwhile, Samsung is fostering VR storytelling at Sundance. Samsung were apparently at Sundance, and they were pitching, not only just pitching VR, but also on the lookout for storytelling people, presumably filmers, writers, whatever, with a view to producing product for VR, I should say. There's a review of something called VR Box. Maria may know about this. VIAR Box, custom cardboard set.
I wrote the review. Yes.
Right. Fair enough. But, actually, maybe I should go back to reading my Twitter feed where I can tell which ones are yours. The attendees at the TED conference this coming year, 2016, will step into something called The Void, a mixed reality world. Basically, apparently, the TED conference this year is going to be taking place in the real world in virtual reality. I mean, maybe it'd be in VR online, but apparently attendees of the actual conference will be kitted out with all sorts of mixed reality kit. And The Void seems to be the name of this world they'll be focusing on as they're running the conference. And as expected, Apple builds secret VR team. And that was the Financial Times, and it was posted as a statement of fact. We don't know what the secret team is, but we do know they've got one and it's working at something. Key factors using virtual reality technology. Key sectors using virtual technology. This is a roundup of basically sectors of commerce and industry that are actually actively using VR technology at the moment, a sort of broad view kind of roundup. A post, it probably came from Google Plus, actually, Open Sim World's NPC controller. I think it's at GitHub or somewhere, but basically we discussed on the show with Noah Malone and others, you know, NPCs, non-player characters, and the way they can be used for telling stories and how they work here in Open Sim as opposed to where platforms they don't work on, like good old Second Life. And at the Open Sim Community Conference, we saw a lot of demos of this too, you know, and seeing the real world applications or the virtual world applications is a very good way to convince people that, you know, it's just not a novelty. What this controller is actually a special set of code that will allow you now to encode these NPCs to do very extensive things like walk around over a long distance, issue advice to people. Basically, it extends the whole idea of the basic NPC that just hangs out with an animation going on and does rudimentary things. This is scripting that allows you to do a hell of a lot more. And I think that you'll have to find the link from my Twitter feed, but I believe it's a link that goes to GitHub and gives you all the code you need for doing this. Nice article here. No room for a home holodeck? Lusting after that. Yes. That's why VR will bring arcades back. Now, this is an interesting one. Again, we're talking about the out-of-home experience. They are saying that, you know, as the technology for holodecks arrives, you know, not everybody is going to have a spare room to turn into a holodeck. So they think that all these VR devices, be it holodeck or just Oculus-type contraptions, will bring back a resurgence in arcades. The places you went to play, I don't know, Space Invaders and things way back in the day. You know, arcades of sort of with games that people play at home and PlayStations and things. The arcade culture has sort of declined, but this article thinks it will come back with a vengeance as VR really takes off. Build your own Arduino-powered virtual reality indoor cycling system. My iPad is talking to me on the other end of the room. I don't know what the hell it's doing. I didn't say Siri or something, did I? Anyway, sorry about that. Arduino is what is sort of home computing devices that you can buy real cheap. It's for hobbyists, but these days these tiny little motherboards and their processing stuff are very powerful devices. And this basically is the instructions how you can take one of those indoor exercise bikes and rig it up for next to nothing using one of these Arduino devices to give you a virtual reality display as you're doing your cycling exercises. So instead of getting onto your cycling machine in the corner of the room and doing your exercises, it actually connects to a virtual reality world where you can cycle around in a virtual reality environment, which is obviously a bit more cheerful than just sitting in the corner with your exercising your legs. Alone.
Didn't IW do something like that as well with the exercise? You connect up in something and then you walk around. It's an app or something that's connected to Inworlds. And when you're exercising, it's the avatar is exercising with you.
Yes, it's a plugin that used, I think it was an iPod app or an iOS app. Or something. I remember joining up the team to try that out, and for some reason I wasn't able to. I think maybe I didn't have the right device or something. But yes, I've even seen in Second Life, I've seen a few experiments which can interact with web cameras and all sorts of other things that may be plugged in. And you know, their server takes over everything and starts controlling your avatar and stuff like that. And of course, we've got Maria will know the name, but there's that circular sort of walking contraption where you a treadmill kind of thing.
Omnidirectional treadmill from Matrix.
Yeah, exactly. So you can walk around in these things. So you know, everybody's coming up with a new little input device that sort of makes you think, oh, well, I can get real world exercise while I'm in virtual reality. Just as we're coming up with devices that enhance the visual aspects of it too. So it's all sort of part of, it's all fragmented parts of one big equation. We don't really quite know where it's all going yet. But it's great to see it all happening, that's for sure. How the growth of mixed reality will change communication, collaboration, and the future of the workplace. Bronwyn Stuckey, I believe that's the pronunciation, has been announced as one of the main keynotes at Virtual World's Best Practices Conference. That was literally today, a post today. I posted a little video on my main Twitter feed this morning advertising something called Sketchfab. I don't really know much about it, but it looked damn nice. It was basically an interactive virtual world that seemed to be running on mobile devices, and you had the option of viewing it normally or putting it into a Google Cardboard and viewing it in more immersive 3D. And it had a very nice finished quality, the sort of thing we see in OpenSim or Second Life rather than super high res, you know, photorealism. But, you know, very similar to the, you know, I think that's why I liked it. The environment felt very similar to what we see in OpenSim and on the hypergrid. And Thursday, Ember had a post as well as her Safari roundup at pingsfromtheafterlife.com. Pingsfromtheafterlife.blogspot.com, I think. Anyway, check my Twitter feed. She had an interesting article this morning on getting seen in OpenSim. This basically was some thought she had about, you know, enhancing your visibility, especially as OpenSim is now becoming with the hypergrid, it's a very big, multi-complex place. And, you know, these were her hints at sort of getting yourself noticed, you know, if you have an event place or a nice destination or whatever, how to maximize your chances of getting seen in the vast haystack. That is the
big giant light bulb above your head might work.
Yeah, yep. A big beam that shows off on the map and turns the map into...
I'm here, you know, flashing.
Yeah, the map comes up and shows the entire hypergrid, and then there's one beeping light saying, come in. Yeah, I know. Okay, that's it for me. So, Maria, you can continue with the ones that were yours and anything else.
Oh, well, I don't know. I think you hit them all.
Yeah, but I didn't go into the detail, did I?
All right. So a lot of news coming out this week, both in OpenSim and in the virtual reality space that's, you know, outside of OpenSim. So I'm going to start out with the stuff that's outside OpenSim. Now, we talked about DigiWorlds and the Kitely Market merchant who goes all export last Sunday, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Did we discuss?
Yeah, yes, we did. Sorry. Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to start out from there. Okay. So Google put out a whole bunch of statistics this week. Which were some great statistics. They said that 5 million Google Cardboards have been shipped. 25 million VR applications have been downloaded through the Google Play Store. And 350,000 hours of virtual reality videos have been watched. And now they didn't say how many non-virtual reality videos were one of giant screen TV inside yours. There are now more than 1,000 different virtual reality applications in the Google Play Store. And more than 750,000 virtual reality photos have been taken with the Cardboard Camera app, which was just released last month. So that's pretty amazing. And more than 500,000 students have gone on virtual expeditions as part of the Google Expeditions program. We talked a more about that earlier, late last year. Google was giving out Google Cardboards and Mattel ViewMasters to schools in combination with smartphones and tablets. And the teacher would use the tablet to guide the students through a virtual experience, kind of like a Magic Schoolhouse kind of thing for those who watch PBS here in the United States and our little children. Google also upgraded its software to support spatial audio, which makes for a more immersive experience. That's a great thing. And there's rumors coming out that it's working on its own high-end headset. So right now, the specs that Google has are for a cardboard set. And although a lot of people are making them out of plastic and other materials, the main spec is for the cardboard. I think it's really interesting if Google starts making its own set to compete with, say, Gear VR, because the Gear VR has some extra sensors and stuff in it, and this will help Google understand what's required to be in the smartphone. So maybe the next edition of the Android operating system will have better support for virtual reality, because of course smartphones were not initially designed to be virtual reality machines. They were originally designed for people to talk on a phone and surf the web.
Yeah.
So if Google adds that functionality to smartphones and other manufacturers, you know, pick up on it because they're part of the whole Google Android ecosystem, that is a really good thing for mobile virtual reality in general. One thing I was curious about that Google did not address, their 5 million cardboard viewers, they had a picture to go with it. The picture was all cardboard, all different versions of cardboard, except for the Mattel ViewMaster and the Goggle Tech glasses. There weren't any of the Chinese headsets on there. And according to some reports from the Chinese media, they're selling 200,000 to 300,000 of them a month on the Chinese websites. So now they're not, I don't know if Google even considers them to be cardboard headsets though, because a lot of them don't comply with the cardboard specs.
Yeah.
They don't have a QR code. A consumer's jury-rig a QR code afterwards. Mm. Like I've made a few QR code for those headsets. And they don't come with the Google Cardboard app. They come with the Chinese manufacturer's own applications. So they're kind of very similar to Google Cardboard, almost indistinguishable from a Google Cardboard, because you can still run all the Google Cardboard apps on them. And I, for example, love some of these headsets. But I don't know if Google considers them to be part of the official kind of numbers.
I suspect not. I mean, there was... I bought an Android little box for an Android TV a few years ago, and shortly after that I bought my first pad, which was made by Tempo, who are a hi-fi maker, and you know, it wasn't capacitive screen, but neither of them were, and so they're very hard to operate. But also they had things like default YouTube apps and stuff like that, which weren't actually Google's apps. They did go to YouTube, but they were selective, and all these apps have been developed in China or somewhere, wherever these devices were made. And certainly the Android operating system where they were running was some kind of dedicated firmware that had been adopted, you know, adjusted for their device that couldn't be upgraded by Google or anybody else. You couldn't even get fruit at the real Google on these devices. So I suspect a lot of stuff coming out of China, maybe even South Korea and other places, is actually on a limb of its own. In other words, they've customized operating systems to become firmware of their own, or they've got different types of sensors in them. I mean, they've picked up on cardboard maybe as a model. I mean, it is so successful that you can imagine, you know, if anybody can make their own cardboard thing, it makes sense that people in other countries are making their own and maybe using different kinds of maybe cheaper components and stuff to get the mass market. So I'm not, you know, I suspect there is a point at which Google consider, you know, Android offshoots, cardboard offshoots and things like that to be inspired by them, but not really to be part of their own, you know, core.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's a sign that, first of all, these are definitely kind of mass market applications, because the biggest use of these things is consuming media. Yeah. The 360 photographs, the virtual reality videos, all those cute little promo apps, and the cute casual VR games. So this is definitely not the high-end gamer demographic that we're talking about here. This is a low-cost, easy to use, super convenient. You don't have to be plugged into a computer to do this. Obviously, it's mobile. You can take this on a train with you or on a plane. So the very, very different kind of demographic from the one we generally think of associated with virtual reality, which is high-end gaming, very complicated games, big, expensive workstations. So for everybody who asks, well, when is mass gaming going to overtake high-end gaming? The question should be the other way around. Is the high-end gaming ever going to overtake the general purpose mass market gaming? Because we've got over 5 million of these already out there, and actually zero of the high-end devices in consumer hands just now.
I mean, I think you look at, I mean, I don't keep up with Facebook anymore, but I remember, you know, what was it, Farmville, that was the big thing on Facebook for a time? You know, that was a game. It was immensely popular. But, you know, it was a completely different thread from the gaming community that have gaming systems and high-end graphics and that. It was a very casual... You know, it's like doing a crossword or a Sudoku in a newspaper. It was just a casual thing to do, and that's a very different market from what you call the even.
It's a different product yeah. segment. I don't know about different. It just certainly overlaps. People do both. The high-end gamers who play Call of Duty also have a smartphone, and they also play Angry Birds when they're waiting in line at the supermarket. So it's a different use case. You know, you play Farmville, you play Angry Birds in one location, you play Call of Duty in another location, you play Angry Birds for a couple of minutes, you play Call of Duty for a couple of hours. So it's a different kind of experience and a different, maybe different genre, a different product.
Yeah,
but I think the people involved overlap to a very significant degree.
Okay. I don't know.
Okay. So other stuff happening. You mentioned the Starbreeze headset, and I talked a little bit about how it's a really huge, huge one.
Yeah.
And see, the thing is that they're going to have a marketing issue because no one's ever heard of this headset. So by putting it in a by creating their own arcades and that are built around these headsets that really shine a spotlight on how great they are, assuming that in fact they are great and people do care about 210 degree view, then this is a way for them to get people to look at these. And especially if they put it someplace with lots of media, like Los Angeles, where everybody's going to drop by and take video of them playing this, then they're going to get some publicity, and they're going to get people trying it out. So I think that's a really good thing, especially if the arcades take off and they get more people out there trying out virtual reality headsets.
I do wonder if an interesting thought here is that, you know, there was that article about maybe arcades being revived by virtual reality. But I'm just thinking, let's say I operate a chain, maybe international or national chain of arcades, you know, in a bygone era almost, and I'm going to be updating, right? And I see this coming. I imagine that there are a lot of companies out there who will actually actively want to develop their own headsets at an economical price for their arcades. I mean, rather than go to people like Oculus and buy bulk from Oculus. On a certain scale, if you see what I mean, if you've got a huge chain already there to go. You know, it may be, for example, that people that buy an Oculus Rift, which is a personal buy, will want this, that, and or every conceivable thing in it, whereas an arcade may only put into their headsets the things that are relevant to their particular arcade experience. So it may be on the manufacturing level to be doing their own for their own arcades that actually has a certain economy in it. And at the same time, of course, from our point of view, we'll promote virtuality.
Well, the arcade requirements are going to be quite a bit different from the personal user. You need a sturdier headset. You also need to have a headset that can be sterilized easily because you don't want to give people... you know, whatever lives in your hair.
Yes.
You know, the...
this is very true, very true.
people can get grossed out very easily. So you want all this. You're going to have kids spilling stuff on it. You're going to have, you know, teenagers smelling it up with their stinky perfumes. You know, so there's definitely going to be some requirements as to... As to what you're going to have on a headset.
In an arcade, for sure.
But you also can charge more for it because the arcade is gonna make money on this headset.
Yeah, yeah, they'll be charging for the experience, not the product. You know, not the physical product. So yeah.
After they'll be renting it out, so they can make quite a bit of money with it, and they can also sell other stuff. They can also have you. They can sell food to the people who stand around watching, you know, whatever it is that they're going to do. So there's definitely money making opportunities for them there based on this headset. So they can charge a little bit more for it. And again, I think that's a great marketing thing. Okay. Now the reason why, I mentioned that they're going to need the marketing thing is because the GDC, this is the Game Developers Conference, they're having their conference in March, and they do a survey every year. They do a state of the industry survey where they survey all the people who are going to come to their conference and ask them about stuff. And so they surveyed like 2,000 people. And 19% of the developers said they were working on Oculus Rift games, followed by Gear VR at 8%, Google Cardboard at 7%, and HTC Vive and Sony PlayStation each had 6%, and nobody else was even on the radar. So,
interesting. I'm surprised PlayStation was low down on that list of developers.
It has to do with brand name recognition. Because 83% of developers had tried some kind of headset, 77% had tried an Oculus Rift, 46% had tried a Google Cardboard, 31% had tried a Gear Rift, only 21% have tried a PlayStation VR, and 19% tried an HTC Vive. And I think this is because the Oculus has been sending out its headsets for a couple of years now. And there's VR groups all over the planet where people bring in headsets to share so other people can try them out. I've tried Oculus several times at these kinds of conferences and meetups in various incarnations of the Oculus Rift. So I've been watching it develop. By going to these things, I've been able to try out the HTC Vive exactly once. And the PlayStation VR, I've never actually even met it in the wild yet. So, and I think, I spend quite a bit of time with this. So the fact that it's so hard for me to do this, even though I go to a lot of these conferences, I think the same is probably going to be true for developers. They're going to have a hard time getting their hands on one of these devices.
Yeah, it's like it's a bit like, you know, we talk about walled gardens and closed ecosystems, don't we? Even with Apple. I mean, you know, Sony do tend to do everything in-house, and it's their own Sony world, software, hardware, everything else. And, you know, if they, you know, if they haven't brought, sent these things out years in advance to developers, then developers are by, you know, they have to ignore it because they've got nothing to try stuff out on.
Yep.
So, yeah, I mean, that makes perfect sense. Oculus have certainly been in a prime line.
Now, and another stat that I like from there is that 75% of developers said that virtual reality was sustainable in the long term, that we're not saying this is just going to be a fad. And I think this is interesting. Mm-hmm. But one developer who said that maybe this first generation isn't worth it, but it will get there.
Yeah.
So, and I personally agree with him. I think that the first generation of games are going to suck because people don't know what they're doing. You make people sick. You're not taking full advantage of the medium. The devices still have a lot of work to go. They're not finished. We don't have the interfaces designed yet. It's all up in the air. So definitely, if I was going to spend millions of dollars on a new game, given the size of the market right now, I mean, I'd be in there because I want to learn how to do this. I don't want the market to pass me by, but also I'd be very careful about not investing too much money because I know I'm not going to be able to get it back. If I make a new Call of Duty, I know I'm going to make it back. So that's going to be a problem. Now, the other reason to make games for the Oculus Rift, versus the Google Cardboard, is that games on Oculus Rift are priced higher. People spend more money for it. On the Google Cardboard, people will spend less money. They expect to pay 99 cents for a game. And I think this is the reason why, even though more developers have tried the Google Cardboard than Gear VR, 46% to 31%, slightly more developing for the Gear VR than for the Google Cardboard, because a lot of the games on the Gear VR are priced at $10, $9.99, as opposed to the Google Cardboard, where they're priced at 99 cents.
Well, I'm just going back in time here. Everything old is new again. I mean, you know, there's plenty of stuff from VR from the 70s, which is graphically crap and stuff. But, you know, I've been on rides up at Longleat, for example, which is puts you in a simulated environment, but you know the software was custom written for it and it's dated now, and the same with the arcade stuff that's been around in the past, whereas now, you know, you're developing you know, hopefully, presumably, consumer software to go with these devices. But well, you know, I think it is a different thing, because in the past VR experiences, such as they've been, have been the experience, and they've definitely been the out-of-home thing. Whereas now we're moving, you know, when these people are saying that VR is here to stay, they're considering it in the context of home users, or maybe mobile users, it doesn't really matter, but, you know, the general public having something of their own and realizing the actual value of VR from that point of view. That's why I think the arcades will play a big part, because people who don't see the purpose of it will possibly experience something, you know, in an out-of-home experience, and then realize how compelling it is, and they'll then want something at home, just as somebody who enjoys films in the days of cinema suddenly wanted a videotape player or a DVD when they come along, because it brings to the home an experience they've actually gotten used to. And
the old time we had arcade machines, and we didn't have PlayStation and Xbox until the arcades came out, and then all of a sudden PlayStation was making the arcade games for home use.
Exactly. They were bringing the out-of-home experience to home. But also, I look back to, on the price point, I think back to the days when CD-ROMs were just becoming available. And forget the multiplayer online games. They actually changed the face of gaming anyway, because people were able to buy these CD-ROMs and play on computers. Forget the consoles, but actually play just on the bog-standard computer. Ever better and better games from a graphical point of view, and presumably on a coding point of view too. I wasn't a gamer. But I remember reading at the time, you know, it was only a matter of years where between the expenditure on making a game became more expensive than making a movie, and yet the income from those games was beating Hollywood at their own game. You know, it would cost you £5 to go to the cinema to see a film, but people were quite happy to spend maybe £40 on the latest computer game. So, you know, and they would play it for months, so they did get value for money. But, you know, if the value for money is there, I don't think the price necessarily is a limiting factor. I think a good VR experience that can be used again and again and takes a long time to get through, people might pay quite large sums for. Not just the $9.99, they'll pay $50 or something for a good game that will last them for a year, you know. So I think they'll probably, in you know, sure there'll be 99B games, but there'll be all stages thereon, depending on how developed they are and, you know, their values to people. So I think there'll be a lot of different price ranges for the software. It won't be limited to just the cheap one or the middle cheap one. I reckon there'll be pretty expensive stuff there too. Just like a CD-ROM from the National Gallery in London featuring high-res pictures of all their art. You know, it cost a lot of money. You know, you didn't just go in there and get a £5 CD-ROM as a souvenir. I think they charged £100 or £200 for it. You know, so it's, you know, there's all sorts of price ranges in there, which I think are dictated by the value of the product, you know, the, whatever the product in the product is, if you see what I mean.
That's interesting.
Okay, on to more.
You know, sorry, Maria, but I read an article this week on Android Headlines that kind of summarized the sense, too, that all of these devices we put on our eyes and our ears are also an intermediate technology. I mean, you know, at some point, and probably not that far off, probably not as far off as we might think, you know, the content will go directly into our brains, you know, with implanted devices. So, you know, we're going to have these battles, but, you know, there's another technology waiting on the doorstep.
Do not get the implant. It'll be obsolete within a year. You'll be really embarrassed. Your kids will make fun of you.
Hang on, it's going to be made by Microsoft, and you're not going to trust.
Oh, lordy! You can't
trust it.
Next thing you know, I'll be waking up with commercials in my eyeballs. No thanks.
I should stop saying implant because
Windows 10. Please upgrade to Windows 10 1,500 times.
It'll be magnetic resonance. That's what's going
to
happen.
Okay, back to the future.
A couple of quick product reviews. Unicorn VR, one of my freelance writers, Ariba Khan, a hyper good business, got her a Unicorn VR headset, which is one she wanted. So if you want to be a freelance writer for hyper good business, that's one of the perks of the job, is we get you a headset. And she picked this one, and she says it's a lightweight headset, very easy to use. The two disadvantages to it is the fact that it can only hold a certain number of sizes of cell phones, and it's a tight fit, and the fact that it has a magnet button on the side. Magnet buttons are the first generation of the Google Cardboard. They're not, and she says that it can fall off and you have to put it back on again. So aside from those two things, it's a $30 headset. So if you're thinking of spending $20 for a piece of cardboard, you can, you know, for $10 more, you can get something that's very sturdy like this. You can like really beat it up if you're in a beating up headsets kind of mood. And you might like the color scheme, a little black and orange there. All right. And then the other, this cardboard set came to me in the mail. From a manufacturer. I did not pay for it, so that will bias my review or could theoretically bias my review, so you should keep that in mind. It's a piece of cardboard, and it's a cardboard headset, It's a little different from other cardboards in that it has straps, which is nice. It has padding around the nose and a little bit of padding to hold the phone in place as well. And it doesn't have a button. What it does have is openings on the sides so you can just touch the screen. And I kind of think that's it's a nice idea because then you have fewer moving parts. And the fewer moving parts you have, especially when your headset is made out of cardboard, really the better. The other quibble I have with it is it did not come with a QR code posted on the inside of the headset, which every headset should have. I mean, they did email it to me. I do have the QR code. I do post it. But it's a pain in the butt to have to go to your computer, look up a QR code whenever you want to use a headset, especially if you're switching between headsets. So not a good thing. Definitely they should fix that and put the QR code right inside the headsets where it's really convenient to use. The main reason people should be considering this headset is that even though each one of them is like $15 to $17, depending whether you get a strap or not, if you get them in bulk, they are $5 each, and you can get any of your patterns on them. They have a couple of different ones that they showed off for Deloitte and for a couple other companies, and they look really nice. They're really easy to fold up. It comes in this tiny flat box. You open it up, you unfold it in like literally 2 seconds, and you've got your headset. It's really convenient. If you're giving away cardboard sets to your customers and you need to give away hundreds of them, I really like this over the traditional Google Cardboard headset.
Compact and branded at the price.
Well, a couple of other companies do also make branded headsets. I Am Cardboard, Nox Labs, Powis VR all make corporate branded headsets, and they all have slightly different advantages to this. This one, like I said, it's a low price. They're made in Europe, so they will ship them for free to the United States, but if you're in Europe, you'll get them faster. So that's also an advantage if you're, you know, if you're in Europe. And it is really, really easy to use. I do like the extra padding around the face. That is very nice. Most headsets don't have that. And it is a very cute form factor. It folds out very easily. They did a nice job with the ergonomics of it. Yep.
Maria, all right. Animated GIF on your website of the unfolding?
No, I did not. The company sent that to me.
It's very clever. It's very ingenious. Wow.
Yes.
Cool.
All right. So, Avilabs. I finally added them to my hosting directory, as Mal pointed out. I did a little article about their offerings. And in the discussion, in the comments of the article, a couple of their customers said some nice things about them, which is a definite improvement over previous articles I've written about Aviworld.
Is Aviworld part of Yo-Yo?
Yeah, it's the Yo-Yo grid. Yeah.
Oh lordy.
It is not a Yo-Yo grid. Mal calls it the yo-yo grid.
I'm being nasty. I'm
Alex,
sorry.
Alex on the show even called it the yo-yo grid.
Yes,
you know, he's quite genial about it.
Yes. Now the reason I had my doubts and the reason it took me a while to post this article was because Aviworld and Alex have a history of having a beef with their hosting company or a beef with their business partners or personal issues, going away, shutting down the grid with no notice, shutting down all social media accounts associated with the grid, and not giving anybody any updates about what was going on, except like a week or a month or 2 months later, the grid will pop back up again. And he's done this about 6 times. So now if you're just a social user and you go to the grid to dance with other people who speak Portuguese, which is apparently very popular on this grid, although it's based in America. If that's what you use the grid for, then the fact that the grid is going down is not that big of an issue. But if you are using them as a hosting company for your own grid, then having that go out of business with no notice because he had a problem with his partner or his CTO or his hosting company or whatever, that is a much, much bigger issue. So so you have to weigh that against the prices. The prices are great. A mini grid, no startup fees, is $55 a month, and you get either 12 regions or a 16 region VAR region, which is an excellent price. And a full grid with 40 regions starts at $150 a month, which is also a really, really good price for per region. An additional single regions are 15,000 prims each, are $5 a month, with bulk discounts available on top of that. So if you buy 10 at once, you get them for $30 a month. So this is a really, really great price, one of the lowest prices out there. But again, be prepared for things to go wrong. Have lots of backups, your own backups. I mean, Alex said, oh, we do all the backups. Well, that's nice for them, but make sure you have a set of all those backups. In particular, you need backups of all the regions on your grid. You need backups of all the user inventories on your grid. And if you can figure out a way to do this, a backup of the entire grid system with its database and everything else, the whole folder that it lives in. If you can do that, then you can just move the whole thing to a new provider, upload it, and be back in business again within a day if you have all that. So
Alex's biggest issue is that he even brags about it, and I've even heard him on this show at one time say, I'm going to have the prices low, I'm going to take everybody, and then I'm going to jack them right up. Sorry. And I'm just going to put everybody else out of business.
He has tried in the past to raise and lower prices. If, in fact, I believe his first business model was to be the most expensive grid, thus creating an in-world land market, which did not work for many obvious reasons. Why would somebody buy a plot when they can get a whole region for the same price, right?
He also said that he was going to take over Osgrid.
Yeah.
And as long as he was the president of it, he'll supply all the servers they need and everything for nothing. But
yeah,
there was always
many buts, really. I mean, I think I think it's fair to say what they've got on offer. But I mean, remember that, you know, the Great Canada Grid here, when it started, was offering land for next to nothing and things at cost. Yeah. But they, you know, and I'm sure Roddy would be quite open about this. You know, you forget about the inherent cost in scaling. You know, if people do take up, it's more and more work. And you may realize that what for a few customers was fine, for when you're tackling a lot of customers, your overheads go up. That really is not workable anymore. So
that's the other thing I was going to point out with Avi Labs. And I've talked to him a few times about this, is that they have a lot of manual processes. Mm-hmm. Now, a manual process, especially if your people are working for free because they think it's cool, is nice and cheap way to handle a small number of customers. Mm-hmm. Because creating automated processes takes development time. You have to, build this whole infrastructure for automation. So you could save time and money up front by doing everything yourself manually. But like Mal pointed out, you can't scale that because at a certain point, you run out of free hours you're able to put in. You're going to have to hire people. And at that point, you realize that people are expensive. Maybe you're cheap, but other people are expensive because you are the owner of your company. You have sweat equity, you're willing to put in a time, but other people who are just there on a per hourly basis, they don't have the same feeling about the company, that it's a baby, that that they should be donating all their time to it. Why should they donate their time to making you rich? No, they want to get paid like a normal person. So this means that if you are sticking with manual processes, after a certain point, you either have to raise your prices or you have to invest in automation. There's really no other alternative. And if you're going to be investing in automation, that means you're probably going to be spending money to pay for somebody to automate things. So those are the things I would watch out for, that costs will at some point go up if this will be a viable business, not because he's going to drive everybody out of business, because that's not going to happen. We've got plenty of competitors in this space. He's not going to be able to raise his prices after he drives everybody out of business, no matter how much he might brag about it.
Yeah, but that's how it's
Yeah, but he'll have to raise prices anyway, just in order to be able to support growth. So keep that in mind as well, before you make any long-term business plans about this. Abby Mandelbaum, he's the CEO of YouVisit, has donated a column for me, basically arguing that the key to virtual reality success isn't going to be so much the headsets or the games, but the ability to have user-created content. And that the price of the headsets, the price of the cameras are dropping. So you're going to need to have things that people can share with one another. And right now, all the media's attention on the big name content, who's developing games, who's making videos, and not so much on ways for people to share content with one another. And I think the Google Camera is one step forward to creating shareable content, and that we need more. We need to be able to have products to share bigger experiences.
I think that's
a good point.
That is definitely how things go viral these days.
Yeah.
You know, people share this, they share that, and if you share an experience with somebody, then you know the experience, you know, gets its value. it's all about immersion, of course, but there's a big difference between an immersive experience and something that an environment that is fully immersive under your own control. And, mm-hmm. you know, I think it's immersive experiences will always be big, like the big cinema hits or is the one with the latest special effects. And, you know, people do go for immersive experience where they don't necessarily participate. But the modern trend in everything from social networking to virtual worlds is collaborative, participatory sharing environments. So mm-hmm. I think they probably nailed it on the head there to a great extent.
Right.
Not totally, but, you know.
Okay. Other news, OpenSim is Island Oasis will join the Hypergrid today. Thanks, guys, for the heads up. I totally was going to miss that. Mm. They're having a town hall meeting today, and they posted an ad for a part-time events coordinator to help promote their events on the Hypergrid for real money. As a result of their transition, the number of grids on the Hypergrid is going up to 221. Only 71 public grids are still closed grids with the Hypergrid turned off. Of those, Inworlds is the largest. And I posted a little chart showing the active users on the closed grids and the active users on the Hypergrid. And a little over a year ago, the lines crossed. So we had the same number of users on the Hypergrid as in the closed grids. And then after that, the active users on a Hypergrid has just shot up. It almost doubled, while the number of active users in the closed grids have stayed the same or even dropped a little bit. So very dramatic change there in the past year for the Hypergrid. So good job, folks, especially with a lot of the cross-grid events coming up. And I will leave it up to Leslie to talk about one of those events. That's
Maria, can I ask
today.
A question while I'm here?
Yep.
Can I ask why InWorlds is even
involved in OpenSim, considering their platform is not even anywhere close to OpenSim anymore, and it is a closed grid. It's more SL-like than it is in OpenSim.
Because they're not anything else. And when people come to OpenSim, they often come to InWorlds first. The people who do come to InWorlds tend to visit many other OpenSim grids as well in the surveys that I've done. It definitely seems to be an entryway to OpenSim. They bring in a lot of people every month, and every month a lot of people leave OpenSim for other grids. It seems to be that they stay there for a while, they learn more about OpenSim. The hard part is configuring your viewer the first time for a non-SL grid. That is like the big technical challenge. Once you've done that and hopped over the fence outside of Second Life, it becomes a lot easier to tour all the other OpenSim grids as well. Mm-hmm. Plus, their software is based on OpenSim. I mean, it's a branch off, but it's still based on it.
It's more Aurora, isn't it?
Whatever, it's still Aurora also came from OpenSim. It's a branch off of OpenSim.
Yeah, so did SL though.
But yeah, no, they're
SL.
SL was the original, and then
the back-end SL software, and the back-end OpenSim software have nothing in common. They're built in different languages, on different architectures, by people who have never even seen the original SL code. And this is because of the licensing issues with the OpenSim code. It was reverse engineered based on the Second Life viewer and messaging system, but it was built from scratch. And InWorld took that OpenSim code and added their own features to it. But a lot of grids do that. Kitely has added a whole bunch of features to the OpenSim code. Avination added a whole bunch of features to OpenSim code. And InWorld and both OpenSim and Kitely and Avination have been donating a ton of this code back. So InWorld recently made a huge code donation back to OpenSim. Avination made a huge code donation to OpenSim. And of course, Kitely has been donating code to OpenSim all along. So they're
we have to remember that, like, back when OpenSim was new, there were a number of places you could go. Iantara ended up on Reaction Grid for a long while before they moved to Unity and stopped the OpenSim side of things. But for a long while, InWorlds was the epitome of OpenSim because it was not big compared with Second Life, but it was big enough. It was attracting a lot of creators. They had more prims to play with. It was more affordable. And it was very much a prototype. But of course, there wasn't any, as far as I know, when InWorld started, the Hypergrid was not yet really invented.
The Hypergrid was already there when InWorld came out. And I remember there was a bit of controversy that they're using this open source software to create this closed commercial grid.
Yeah.
But I have to say that because they were a closed commercial grid, because they charged more for their land, they were able to put more effort into marketing, into support, that many of the open source grids like Franco Grid or OS Grid
could do.
We're not able to do because they're all run by volunteers.
Yeah.
So there's a trade-off there. On the one hand, they're a closed grid. On the other hand, because of that, they're able to charge more for land. They were able to provide a nice starting experience.
But I'm also thinking in terms, because I've had her on the show twice, I think. In terms of development, you know, I think any grid worth its salt now on OpenSim, even if they're not hypergrid enabled at the moment, will be trying to stay close to the core.
Mm-hmm.
Because they realize that this interconnectivity is quite possibly the future, and of course, in our case, we believe it is for sure.
Well,
but in the early days of InWorlds, they probably were very keen to advance the development of InWorlds without really being conscious that of the opportunities that would later open up. I know Inworld sort of sometimes regrets that it can't be on the hypergrid, and it's not that they could be as willing as hell to join the hypergrid, but they can't because their code has diverged too much from the core OpenSUNE code. But I think they did lead the way in many ways.
Their recent code donation might indicate that they're working to address that issue.
Yeah.
Because the main reason to stay closed is content protection. Mm. And as the news out of Kylie Market is coming out, that is becoming less and less of an actual issue for content creators. So, and the fact that you can't get access to event attendees from around the hypergrid, given the size of the growing hypergrid population, is also becoming an issue. Mm. But yes, you're right. They've painted themselves into a corner. They invested a lot in technology early on and it gave them a head start over other grids. But because they didn't share that technology back, other grids took, you know, different options for solving those same problems.
Mm.
So you have Inworlds by itself over here fixing technology issues, and all the other grids, plus IBM, plus Intel, plus the U.S. military, plus a bunch of other organizations doing different solutions to those same problems.
Yeah.
And over time, one group of small developers on one grid is having to compete against all these other developers working for free and sharing all their stuff back.
Collaborating.
And this means that Inworlds had trouble rolling out mesh, rolling out variable size regions, rolling out several features that OpenSIM in general had really quickly. And Inworlds has to reverse engineer all of that by itself without being able to use the free code that all the other grids use.
Yeah.
And this puts it also at a disadvantage because all the other grids get the code for free. They can spend their money on event planning and customer support and, you know, hands-on marketing and whatever else they need to grow the grid. And Inworld is having to spend their money just keeping up with the technology.
Yeah.
Well, I was just curious. Anything.
And so anyway, so Island Oasis was one of the mid-sized grids that was closed. And for mid-sized grids, it's particularly difficult to be a closed grid. And Third Rock Grid was one example that turned on Hypergrid last year. Because if you're a closed grid, you have to be the largest grid. Because how are you going to attract people to your grid if you're a small closed grid? Not only do your merchants not get access to the biggest possible customer base if they're into the closed system, then they go to Inworlds, but also they don't give access to the whole hypergrid user base. Mm. So it becomes a self-defeating kind of cycle.
And we forget Second Life there. I've received a and I may have been this morning here in Canada from a vendor, and but I thought it was quite interesting. It was all new mesh stuff. I went over and picked up a couple of walls of flowers from them. But it was quite interesting because they gave their Canadian store location, the main store, and two outlet locations. They're in several places on the grid. But then they gave out the address of their Second Life marketplace. Linda Labs marketplace, this is. Mm-hmm. And he said, check the catalog there. And he just said, if you see anything on my Second Life marketplace page that you want here, just let me know so I can upload it. And I thought that was interesting. You know, he's clearly using the Second Life marketplace to advertise what he's got and then saying, well, you know, if you want it, I'll bring it here for you. Right. Kind of rather cheeky, but I like that.
Yeah, it's also nice that it's the merchant themselves doing it you know, making it friendly. Okay. All right. Speaking of the market, another Kitely merchant is talking about exporting content. In this particular case, it's high-end scripted and rigged content by Kayaker Magic. And His store is Ocean Engineering, and he makes dinosaurs and boats and stuff like that. It's one of the top 10 merchants on the Kylie market. And he said that he understands that selling on a hypergrid is a risk. Because with copybot, people can only steal the appearance of an object. On the hypergrid, people can set up their own grids or give themselves god powers and steal all the scripts and rigging as well. And he says that, you know, this can happen. This is a risk. But he says, but I probably wasn't going to sell many copies to them anyway. If I let them convince me to not sell anything export, then I'll be denying myself all the profit from all the honest people in the metaverse who are willing to pay. Exactly. Plus, he said the crooks aren't going to be able to support his scripts. And then there's other things he does about how he creates content. And he says he likes selling on a Kylie market because it makes it easier for his customers to find him. And Kylie CEO Elon Tochter confirmed that he is one of the top 10 merchants and that Kylie now delivers 220 different grids. All right, so a couple of quick news bits. A couple of companies have had their quarterly earnings reports this week. Zuckerberg said he's happy with Oculus pre-orders and that he expects the virtual reality to be a new big social thing, and that's why they're investing in it. We knew this already. Tim Cook says that VR is not a niche, but that's all he said. He said one sentence about virtual reality's earnings call. He said, in terms of virtual reality, no, I don't think it's a niche. I think it's really cool and it has some interesting applications. Okay. So they did hire a top virtual reality user experience researcher, bought some companies, and there's been a lot of rumors out there, and I included links to a few of them about the fact that they're working on getting into the VR business. I'm looking forward to it because I'm a big fangirl of Apple, and I want to see what they're going to do.
Aren't we all?
you mentioned the second Indian phone company. So last week, Lenovo bundled its K4 Note smartphone with an Ant VR virtual reality headsets and sold 10,000 sets in less than a second. So that was apparently worked really well for them. And another company, iBerry, out of Hong Kong, they decided to do the same thing. They bundled their new Oxus Stunner smartphones with the Oxus VR headset. And the headset itself sells for about between $100 on Amazon and $45 on GearBest. It seems to be like a rebranded version of the Vir Glass headset. And they also bundle it with a free iWatch, Oxus iWatch, which normally retails $117. And the whole bundle is $220. So basically, you get the phone for free.
Yeah. And it's a stunner, by all accounts.
Yeah.
Oh, God, anybody that calls a mobile phone a stunner, come on.
Yeah. But it's interesting the way they pick the headsets. The Lenovo K4 Note has a really high res screen, and this Oxus Stunner has a pretty low resolution screen, just 720 by 1280 pixels. And the headset that they picked has a narrow field of view, just 68 degrees. Normally we want like 90 degrees or above. So for 68 degrees of field of view, that's a good fit for watching movies on a giant virtual screen, because if you expand it more than 68 degrees, you're going to see every individual pixel. And so I think that this is a nice combination there. They picked a headset with a narrower field of view to go with this low resolution phone so people can watch movies on giant virtual screens.
And I think that is one of the main attractions. I mean, we refer to it as VR, virtual reality, inhabited worlds and stuff like that. But, you know, I'm sure a lot of this take up of the plug in your smartphone thing is just to bring a big screen in front of your eyes, you know, like television. I mean, that has got to be For people who aren't interested in actual interactive virtuality or anything else like that, that has got to still be a compelling reason for getting the cardboards and things. You know, they, instead of going out and paying hundreds on a big screen TV that only they will watch, then why not just stick your smartphone in something that brings it right forward into your eyes? You know, that cinema experience is, you know, a compelling factor, I think, in the cardboard type.
And for my last story, I want to turn it over to Leslie. There's a treasure hunt beginning today that covers 16 different grids. And I'm one of the sponsors of this treasure hunt. So it's a lot of fun for me because I didn't have to do anything. Leslie did all the work. I just get to take the credit. the idea for this germinated on actually a previous Inworld review with the three of us sitting right here on these very chairs, and has turned into a real thing. So I'm very proud of that. And I'm hoping Leslie can tell us more about it.
You know, it's so funny. I didn't even realize that until Leslie mentioned it before we came on air. You know, sort of, I think you, Maria, asked who was actually behind this. And then Leslie said, well, you and me and her. My answer was, I think it was just Leslie on her own, wasn't it? however, I will add to that. We were talking beforehand, actually, and of course, I was on Safari earlier in the week, always a good place to go, Wednesday at noon. Pacific time, the Hypergrid Safari takes off and goes to three or four locations. And one of the locations, which I got to early, thank goodness, on Wednesday, was Craft Grid, where, of course, they were celebrating... they were celebrating their anniversary. I've forgotten what... I think, is it 5 years or something? Anyway, there was a huge party, and it seems the region was absolutely packed. And as far as I know, there's probably no room left when the safari actually arrived, for real. But congratulations to Craft Grid on their anniversary anyway. So, yeah, there's a few things here. As I introduced at the top of the show, we are joined by Leslie Kling from Tangle Grid. So welcome back again, Leslie. We've heard from you a bit already. There's a few weeks ago, you offered to bring, we did mention it on the show, though you didn't come. I know you have a major region that some of these Star Trek people have opened up, for example. of course, you run your regular expos, and there's an expo coming up. Plus, as Maria has just mentioned, there's the treasure hunt. And in fact, I don't know if James is able to come around a bit, but we actually have your treasure hunt stand on the side stage here. And it's actually been here since the last hunt 2 months ago. And of course, it's actually the very same dispenser that operates the new hunt. So simply the data's changed on it.
Automatic. Done through the administration of the hunt itself.
Let's give us a refresher on the nature of this hunt, I think, first, before we actually start looking at specific things on Tangle Grid, because the hunt itself is hypergrid wide, for one thing. So maybe just tell us a little bit about it.
Okay. First off, the treasure hunt is, like you said, for all grids that are hypergrid enabled. It's not for just Tangle. Tangle developed it between, you know, TMAC did the scripting, I did the designing of the thing, and blah, blah, blah. We are only the designers of it. We are not the owners of it, if you want to say it that way. It's for everybody on the hypergrid, every grid on the hypergrid. You pick one of these stands up at Maria's grid, and if you don't want to do it that way, on the website itself, there's a link that you can download the IAR. What it is the stand that's over on the side stage there is the stand that the people click on to get the kit that has the stuff that they need to put on their regions. Inside the kit is instructions how to do it, is free t-shirts, so if you want to put the box out, so everybody's jumping around is wearing a t-shirt like I'm wearing, is the female version, and the item that you hide on your region somewhere. On that item, you in the description field, you put a hint, a clue to where it might be. On the website, it gives a list of your region. It gives a hint button. You click on that hint button. It gives you the hint where you might locate that item. I can't tell you what it is, because then you just, well, type it in, blah, blah, blah. But it gives you a hint where that item. You go looking for that item on that region, on that grid. TMAC will be updating the next version, which means all the stands will disappear, because we have an automatic system to get rid of all the items, get rid of all the stands. I will redo the new IAR, and I will put a new stand out at Maria's grid. This one, you go to the, let's say you want to come to Great Canadian, for example, for the treasure hunt, find out where the item is. You click on grids and hints on the website, and then you click on the stand. There's a little stand icon, and on there, or on the grid that you want, and then there's on the top of the page, it says Great Canadian Grid. You click on that, it will hypergate you to Great Canadian Grid. And then you see the region list of all the regions that are involved in Great Canadian Grid, for example. It sounds complicated, but once you've done it once, it's very, very easy. We did 3 or 4 test runs on our grid to see how easy it was for people to understand the rules, how easy it was for this. After you get all that done, then the glass, if you drop that glass now, it'll be white. The item will be white. Right. If the grid is offline, or the hunt, I mean, it will turn red. If the hunt is over, but standing by to the next one, it'll be yellow. But that's all in the descriptions. That's all in the information packages. Everything that you need to know is in there.
Thank you.
Prizes. Maria from Hyper Business News has donated some VR glasses worth around $130. Those will be mailed to you if you win them. We've also got MP3 players with speakers. We're talking real life stuff. I'm not talking virtual or box on the floor. Sunbeam is located at Cottage. That's obviously in world. All that stuff you can see what's. And we've also had some cash donations. So there is also cash prizes, real life cash prizes, which will be given to you if you win via PayPal. So as soon as you win it, I get your PayPal address and I send you the cash. That's simple.
So how do you actually win? Is the idea to travel and collect? Because the actual prices I would say put down on other regions is not an actual prize, is it?
It's when you click on the item, you tally points.
Right.
And the one that's got the highest points
gets the prize.
In the fastest time wins the prizes.
Yeah, sure.
And we have a first, second, and third prize. And the hunt runs for a month, because some people can't come in during the week. They can only come in on weekends and this and that and the other thing. So that's why we did it with time. And like, it's all back calculated in the background somewhere. T's got that all mathematically all figured out, but because he's the big scripter guy. But it's. I know the system tells me who's got the highest score, who's got the fastest time, first, second, and third, and a story pretty much. And then that's for a month long. And then we give it a week. We delete all the items. We can do that automatically, no matter what grid it's on. And then the next hunt, the sign that you have over here will change the date of when the next hunt will be. So all they have to do is look there and say, oh, the next hunt's in a week. They already have the kit, unless we do an update. If we do an update, then we have to replace the stand. That's obvious. Right. Because right now what we want to do is when you go to the grids and hints page, you can click on just on the grid part. It takes you to the region, and then you click on the region, and then you hypergate direct. Right now, you have to use the title, because we weren't quite sure how to get the location, blah, 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 to work through the website, because you have to pull that information from many resources to make sure that you can when they click on it, the Hypergate will actually work to take you there.
Right.
But I think we got that figured out now. So the next hunt will have that update on it. So you just click on it and go. Click on it and go. And that sort of thing. But it's all for all grids that are Hypergrid invaded. It's not just one grid. It's all of us.
All grids and all regions, for that matter.
You're only allowed one hunt item per region.
Yeah.
And that also affects VARs. VARs classify as one region because it's all linked together.
Well, we have like six regions down below here. So presumably you could put one on each.
It draws the people to your grid. It draws the people to your region so they look around. Mm. You know, the whole idea was to have more interaction between grids to work together. Not against each other. And I actually am a little disappointed on how many grids are actually participating in this, considering Maria just told me there's 200 some grids out there. I know 70 are closed, but sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly agree. I mean, but then again, you get people like me who completely messed up last time. Probably willingly was ready to participate.
Hey, 16 grids is a great accomplishment for the first time out.
Yeah, but do you see how many only got stands out though? Like that brown. Like, hunt items out.
Well, people are still getting going. And the most of the 200 some grids that are out there. A lot of them are small, like individual people and stuff, and they're just like not aware of what's going on. So, did I give you the? Did we contact them all? Remind me.
Who
did we send out an email to? Did we send out emails to all the grid owners?
You sent it out to.
Yeah, I sent them out
months ago.
So? Yep, I should probably have sent out a reminder. I will do that now.
Well, I'd remind everybody
Is it too late? So maybe,
No. Because it's not too late. We just started today.
Not too late.
So
okay, cool.
Well, I'd remind people watching who, you know, maybe hearing about this and think, where on earth? I mean, if you go to Hyperica, which is Marie's portal grid, you'll be able to pick up what is things to take home and res. And follow the instructions carefully.
Click on the stand to get the kit that you need to put on your region.
Yeah, exactly. I will actually place one we have up here downstairs in the Metaworld Broadcasting entrance region too. So if any of you pop through there, you'll see it as well. And once you've got it, you just take it to your own grid or wherever, follow the instructions and plant it. And hopefully the idea is then you'll be on the list and people taking part in the hunt will head over to your grid or your region.
Look, we got some really great prizes, like those VR headsets, MP3 players with speakers, cash prizes. There are a few interworld prizes, but they're nice. You know, a nice ceiling fan with lights and all kinds of stuff, and a nice house, nice cottage that Sunbeam donated. And I would like to see a lot more of that kind of thing, donations or sponsorship to the hunt, you know, because if this does not fly, I'm going to give it 3 shots, guys. And yeah, you know, we really tried as Tangle Grid to get involved with other grids to be a family kind of thing, and I'm not feeling that. I'm not feeling that love. I'm sorry. But
I think that, I think, you know, it's another issue, it's another story, but, you know, the Hypergrid by its nature is getting bigger. You have some, non-profit, friendly do-it-yourself grids. You've got other commercial grids. You've got, even the way the Hypergrid works can be configured so that, you know, sort of it's half configured, so to speak. I mean, certainly commercial.
That's what we are.
Certainly commercial grids have this, competitive imperative, I think, that, especially on American grids, is very, very prominent. You know, it's one thing collaborating on OpenSync code and everything else like that.
Yeah, but that's free, and that improves them.
I personally think the hypergrid just connecting everything and everybody is wonderful. It's like a web, you choose where to go. And if somebody has a hunt and goes, it takes you to 20 different web pages, you know, because they're participating, fine. But, you know, there will probably always be ones that say they don't want to, you know, collaborate on this because they think it's all organized by TangleGrid or something mistakenly. Just in the same way, you know, some people don't want to deal with the Kitely marketplace because they see it as the same name as Kitely the Grid, which they consider to be a competitor. And, you know, little things like that. You know, I think this is closed minds, you know, really. You just aren't seeing the bigger picture. But, you know, as the world gets bigger, the hypergrid gets bigger, then, you know, the chances of getting every single grid on the hypergrid.
No. I didn't expect that.
Yeah.
Slightly disappointed in how many hunt items are not out. Stands up the hoot shoot.
But
that doesn't do you any good because you can't. The stand isn't for the collecting of the points. Yeah. It's to just dispense the kit that you need, and the information you need to do the hunt.
I think the answer.
And that's where the confusion is.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, and I'm as guilty as anybody, aren't I, here? Because as we found out before the show, I'm sure I took something to a particular cave because I can remember the cave.
I obviously
did something wrong. No, it wasn't a stand. It was the object that was in the folder I was given by the stand. But I don't know. I must have done something wrong.
You got to go over there and look at it. And if for some reason it's... Yeah. Not looking like it's supposed to, which I can't say what it is, then you did it wrong.
Maybe I will IM you tomorrow or something and say, come over and show me how to do it.
I'm more than willing to do that as well. If this will help, you just let me know and I'll come over and I'll show you how to work the thing. If that's how it takes to get the first time around, because you teach somebody something and they pass it on, of course, but... Yay.
Yeah. You know, after talking about Kitely, I mean, I did take the kiosk and I took out the object and I set it in a spot in the region, but I think because my region disappears after time, you know, and then doesn't start up until someone tries to teleport to it, I think it had to reset the object each time and I would have to go there and set the script. Yeah. Does that make sense? So.
It shouldn't.
Okay.
It shouldn't automatically detect that the region's up again.
Okay. So if the region comes back up.
Because I know kindly regions go down, right? You're not there.
Right.
Yeah,
it
should show it. You'll see it on the website. If you go there, you can actually see it. Last time seen, it says.
Okay.
Which means the object is...
There might be some just little glitches somewhere in the OpenSync code. For example, I have some NPCs, right? But every time the region's rebooted, it resets the scripts and they reappear. But occasionally I will arrive on one of my own regions and the NPC that's meant to automatically pop up and greet people that hasn't reactivated, and I have to press on the device to actually reactivate it manually. And I can't, you know, that's the sort of thing I just can't find any explanation for. One time it resets, one time it doesn't. So, you know, there could, in some cases, be just little glitches like that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe on Kitely because it's down when it's not needed.
Yeah.
You know, one time or another, it will. But I think the thing is getting the message out. Maria's just told us in back chat that she sent out 88 emails or something to grid owners. But also, everybody, you know, folks at home watching this show, you know, this particular venture is all about promoting masses of hypergrid locations, be it your region or if you're a grid owner, your grid. And, you know, sort of get in touch with Leslie or me or Maria. And we'll put you in touch with whatever to, you know, get this going. It's in your interest to put down a point, you know, basically you're not donating a prize or anything. You simply when somebody finds this device, they're simply getting points. And as they get more and more points, that's how they're winning this hunt. So it's of no cost to you whatsoever.
And, just a little time and a little adventure.
Yeah, exactly. So if you're viewing the show and you don't know of anybody on the grid, your home grid, for example, that's doing this, then plunk one of your own down or get in touch with your grid CEO and say, hey, tell all the other folks on this grid about it.
Okay, so Leslie, yeah. On the webpage, it shows the grid name and then the region count. I mean, can people with just regions, I mean, that's what I was describing. If I just have a region, would that then show up on that region count column under the grid name? Or is it the grid a grid owner thing only?
No. It's, okay. If you okay. Let me go to grids. You're on there somewhere. You're under Kitely, are you not?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, and then you see there's one. If you look, you guys can't see because I'm on the webpage. And then you see the word hint.
Right.
So you click on hint, and
oh yeah, there it is. All right.
Yeah.
That's it.
And then if you point at the click, you see how it says no hint, buddy. That means in your description field, you didn't put anything, so they can't find it.
Okay, I got it. All
right. Give them a hint, like, you know, the bats fly high in the bell tower. Well, you obviously know it's a bell tower somewhere on this region that has that thing in it.
Yeah, exactly. I like coming up with devious hints.
I'll get it done.
And then and we also have a sponsors page, so all the sponsors are listed and where their prizes were standing and what you will win. We have scores. Once you have like 200 or 300 people playing, for example, because the first time you touch one of those items, it registers you. And it'll be put on the scores list. And if you want to know how you're doing, but there's 200 names there, you just type your name in, search, and it pops up your scores. Questions and answers. If you have some kind of questions you're not sure about, go there. It'll answer most of your questions. If you don't, it says there, contact me, and there's my email address. We also have a contact page. There's me, Maria, and Mel on there, so you can get a hold of us if there's a problem. There's you having technical problems. There's an email. All the information you need is on that website. And if you can't find it, you just email one of us. That's simple.
All right.
Really that simple. And you get your hint on that item.
Right after the show. I'll be right there.
Okay. Okay. I know a lot of people watch this in replay, but whenever and wherever you're watching, that is your task. The moment this finishes, go and find that board, get yourself the box, go and rest.
Well, the worst part is Craft World. They've got 10 out and not a hint on any of them.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah. So, they were too busy partying last time I saw them.
I tried to find an email for them. I couldn't. And I thought, who do I know? I don't know anyone because it's an Italian grid, is it not?
Yeah, I was trying to get somebody from Craft, you know, because of the anniversary to come over on this show. And I've been on the ball before the party crashed, I would have grabbed somebody, you know, who was down as admin from at the party and friended them, but it didn't happen. I crashed. anyway.
Going to Craft World is going to be a real problem to find the hunt item because, like I said, there is no hints on them, so you're really going to search.
10 items here on the whole of Craft World to explore. Yeah, fair enough. Okay. Well, let's move on.
Okay.
Before we run out of time, for that matter.
We
always do. coming back to Tangle Grid specifically, okay. I know you contacted me about 2 weeks ago, firstly, about a new, you can tell us about it, the Star Trek region that opened. But also, of course, you are known particularly for the sort of quarterly expos. I think they're quarterly, aren't they? So maybe you'd like to tell us about the current expo coming up and also the Trekkie thingy.
They're called Genesis. It's a Genesis colony. It's one colony out of many colonies all over the metaverse. SL, Metropolis, Third Rock. I know they're on a whole bunch of other grids, but they have a headquarters. And there's one guy, big top guy. His name is Mike. I can't remember his last name off the top of my head. He runs the whole show for all of them. And they're going to base it in Tangle, the headquarters for all of these. It's a 16 VAR region. which means 16 regions. They're 3/4 of the way done of fixing it all up and making it pretty and everything. And very Star Trek-y. You really have to come and see it. Really well done. And what else?
What's the region called? They get a tangled
Genesis. Genesis Colony.
Genesis Colony. 2 words.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Beautiful place. Beautiful. Doing a really nice job there. The next thing is the expos you mentioned. I will try if I can. We'll get together and see if I can get the three head guys on your show just to maybe give 15 minutes of talk about what they're up to, what they're going to do with it. I know there's going to be role playing. I know there's going to be training schools because I guess they take the Star Trek very seriously. You have to school to get your ranks and stuff like that.
I am hoping maybe with James here or whatever to continue a show which I did one prototype of called Grid Stop. And that would actually, that involves basically hypergridding to a location and having a discussion with particular locations. And it sounds to me like that might be something to schedule for that, where we actually film at the region and have the guys talking.
Yeah, you put 3 or 4 chairs down.
Yeah.
Sit in the middle of somewhere.
Oh, yeah, but we'll move the camera around a bit to actually show off the region too. Definitely go do something on that front. So that might be a good candidate, you know, because as you say, it's a Trekkie traction is quite big. And it's, again, it's a multi-grid sort of thing in its own way, even though.
Yeah, they're allowed to travel between the grids on that, from my understanding. And they can put in for transfers back and forth. And it's really organized. Seriously, they have great big web pages and forums and all kinds of stuff. They're really serious about this.
Mm.
Very serious. They even call each other by their, you know, commander so-and-so when they're typing. The whole nine yards, you know. And anything you say, sir, kind of thing, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, it's pretty cool, but not my thing. I like Trek, but.
Yeah, I know. Well, I mean, using virtual world technologies, you can beam me up, beam me down, not to mention the communicators on holiday.
Oh, they have that. They have that over there, too. They have that over there, too.
I'm sure they do. I'm sure.
Teleporters and all kinds of hello things, but.
Yeah.
And they also have an alien world where you can go train for what do you call it when you train for animals? Not a veterinarian. The other one, botanist. No, you botanist for plants.
Yeah.
For animals, different species and stuff or whatever.
Biology.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. My mind's got blank too on that. So fair enough.
And you also mentioned the expo right now. It starts actually tomorrow. But there's still lots of room left. We got hangers that you can put your items in if you want to show off. It's not selling stuff. It's showing stuff.
Right.
So if you want to have – if you have anything that's got the same theme, like right now we're air and sea. So that can be planes, boats, spacecrafts, anything the air and sea kind of mixture. We have hangers. You get a hold of Hannah Fairport over there. She'll set you all up for a place if you want. And no fees, no nothing. You can hypergate in and drop your stuff.
Interesting. I should probably come looking for a boat or boats. I've got some wonderful boats, but none of them work with the bullet physics engine here. So every time I'm in a boat, I get to the edge of a region and full stop, you know. But apparently with bullet physics, you can actually get boats that are scripted, and they'll, once you're in them, you can actually drive them right across region borders.
Well, this is a good way to find that out.
Exactly.
And we actually encourage the people to put a sign or an information giver of what grid they're on, how you can purchase that item, or if it's on Kitely Market or not. The only thing we don't want to see is I'm just using this as an example, so don't anybody get their fur in a knot.
No selling.
selling of a grid. Like, sit there and say, this is a great Canadian grid, and we're the best, and blah, 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 blah. And there's my boat. kind of thing, you know?
Yeah, it's, yeah, no, obviously, it's, you know, put foot down somewhere.
Yeah, well, we're not trying, we're not afraid of other grids. Maybe that's the problem. Okay,
Roddy here. There's a policy on the Great Canadian Grid, you know, there's, if it's hybrid gridding and all that sort of stuff and promoting it, it's absolutely fine. But, you know, Roddy, understandably, is not happy if there's somebody takes a region here and puts up a sign that seems to be more...
Tangle grid.
Yeah, exactly. seems to be promoting another grid, you know. It's like, it's not so much an embassy, you know, somebody, you know, Tangle grid opens an embassy in Great Canada grid or something. But, you know, I suppose that is kind of plausible. But, you know, to actually take terrain in Canada grid and advertise it as an entrance to Tangle grid is a bit of a different thing, you know. It's interesting. Maybe virtual world grids will eventually actually adopt things like embassies. I know in Second Life, Chilbo, community where our Second Life studio is based, you know, for many years had a portable sort of booth. And the idea is, you know, we would dump a Chilbo embassy anywhere that wanted us to put an embassy. And it wasn't just in Second Life. I think we had the Chilbo region was on Reaction Grid when that was going. And the embassy was, you know, sort of, you know, rest where it was needed. Or even in a, you know, like a Second Life birthday celebration, it would be only there for 2 weeks. But the whole idea is you had a little portable embassy that could contain everything that was needed to promote, you know, the community. And, you know, you just put it down. And, you know, all worlds have embassies. Maybe grids on the hypergrid should have embassies for each other to promote hyergrid traffic, you know, or cultural exchanges or something.
Well, if it's like from a French grid to an English one, or from an Australian one to a Dutch one, or... Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
But an American to an American, that might be like a face slap.
Well, okay, American to American just means a war.
But if you put an embassy, you would put more of a cultural pictures inside of it, not the grid itself.
It would more,
you know what I mean?
Exactly, it'd be more like a consulate than an actual embassy or something.
Yeah,
exactly. And, you know,
I can live with that. If Great Canadian wanted to put up a shop with the Great Canadian Beaver, and because I am Canadian, by the way, so
it's also in little ways. I've had to revise my storytelling plans and things that I originally had here. I'm intent on expanding regions and not doing the whole craft. And you know, I keep having to alter everything basically. But you know, I had this idea that, you know, obviously there are a few hyper gates in Meta World Broadcasting's headquarters. They go to Iberica, they go to Sanctuary. They don't usually go to any specific grid except locations on grids that are hyper ports, if you see what I mean. So my choice of destinations is other hyper ports as opposed to actual grids, which seemed the fairest way to do it.
I have a region dedicated to hyper gates, and they go to every region.
Yeah,
like Maria, you know, Maria's webpage there, where she's got all the hyper gate addresses listed and all that. TMac has found a way to draw that information from her webpage. And make a hypergate that you pick the destination, you pick the region, away you go.
Oh, that's what we want. Yeah. That's,
I'll show it to you. Maybe T would be nice enough to give you one, but.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Yeah.
The
more I have downstairs where people might pop in like that, the better.
But well,
the
even
thing I was actually referring to was I started off downstairs here with lots of, you know, they were like backlots. I saw them as sets people could come to film, and so there were lots of small environments that I entangled together, and I tried to landscape them so they blended as best possible. I've sort of now spreading them out a bit so it's actually a real environment. But the idea is I might have a small patch, you know, in a wooded region that was a magic forest. That's a very popular destination. And the idea was that I would have, as people walked into that region, if they turned a certain way, they would get a collision script with a hypergate that would actually take them to somewhere on the hypergrid that is a fully fledged magic forest.
Yeah.
And of course, the idea there was that in choosing that hyper grid location, I would obviously get in touch with that location to say, check that A, they're going to be online most of the time so that the game works. But secondly, hopefully have a reciprocal thing where if the avatar explores the magic forest and then turns around, they can hypergate back to where they started and then continue along my path, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
So it'd be, it'd be like the Stargate thing where there's always one at one end and one at the other, and, you know, they constantly swap. And, you know, I thought, that's practical. It's a collaborative thing, but it's meaningless in the sense of I'm not promoting that destination any more than they are promoting mine. So it will work out.
Yeah, because you're not really saying, come join here, walk through to the Magic Forest grid and be amazed. Like, you're not advertising the grid itself. You're advertising the location on that grid.
Yeah, as an extension of my own story. I'm an extension to theirs. So, So, but anyway.
And I have the same system. I have the same system in our grid where I have a teleport HUD. And if they go to that place, they can go to different regions on my grid and they have a gate to return back.
Right.
So you don't have to use get the map out and see what all the regions are. They actually go into a room and each region has a gate that goes to that region and they can come back and go to another one. And
anything that helps me not have to scroll through endless landmarks in my
inventory. Amen to that, brother.
You know, and I can only fit X many on the favorites bar, you know, and then it's just hell.
Anyways, I guess we should move on because we are running pretty late for you, Mel.
Indeed, we are. Yes, it's and you're in Holland.
I'm in Holland.
Yeah, so
it's
even later for you. It's now later for you.
Yeah,
so.
Considering I get up at 3 o'clock every morning a.m. My grid. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, you've got about time for that. I'm trying to work this out. You've got about 3 hours.
Oh, I have.
You got about three and a half hours sleep, and then you're up again to run your grid. Great. I sympathize.
I love being a grid owner. You just
I get the impression Roddy has become like that with Canada. You know,
he has a full-time job.
I think every spare minute he has to be in here sorting out something. It's you take a bite, you know, you only find out later whether you can chew it easily, as they say. Okay, so we have the expo, which is all about air and water, probably a lot of vehicles. We have the
Genesis Colony for Star Trek.
Indeed.
And we have the treasure hunt.
Yeah, and we have the hunt, of course.
Mel's going to fix right away.
Anything else exciting on Tangled right now?
We're busy with doing RL structures for companies. Sorry.
Right.
So they give us the plans, we build the building, and then they put it in a 3D. We do a 3D video of it, if you will, a video of the building and the landscaping, and then they ship that off to the customers, and the customers can actually do a walkthrough with a semi-stick. Thing, so they can take a walk through the building that's not even made yet.
I love that. Yeah, so it's a lucrative sideline, I would think, there.
Well, sure. Mel, if you ever get the chance and you come on over, I'll actually show it to you. We've already built one that they have already standing by pictures, and the church actually does exist, and it's built to scale, and the preacher has seen it, and he went, my God.
I bet they did.
He never expected, because he's not virtual worlds. He has no clue anything about stuff. And he goes, "You can do that? How do you guys do that?"
He probably thought his afterlife had arrived early.
And as soon as he saw the original church, he said, "Well, I've got these plans for my architecture, and I want to build a brand new church in 2 years. Can you make me a model of it that you can actually walk through it, sit, and we can do sermons?" And sure. Bring it on over. So we got the plans about 2 weeks ago, and we built it from the prim up, as they say. Not the stone up, but the prim up. And it's ready, done. music, organs, you name it, it's all there. And it's going today to be approved by the council of the church. And hopefully we get more contracts to do that sort of thing.
Proof positive of the practical use of virtual.
And we also have, maybe I shouldn't mention this, but I like to because we need new little help. We have right now a sale. It's called Test Drive a Region. You buy a region for $1. It gives you 10,000 prims. And you try it out for 30 days. You like it, you pay $10 a month after that. That offer ends at the end of February.
Okay. So, well, that might be a good offer.
Well, some people go to grid. They don't know what to expect. They don't know if it's laggy. They don't know if it's if the support is there. They don't know anything. And this way, they can actually live there for a month
and see how it feels.
A feel of the place. Yeah. If you don't like it, you move on.
It's not even in terms of choosing grids and stuff. You know, there are people out there who've just never had a region of their own anywhere, or have no experience landscaping, building, or anything else. And you can just say, well, here's something that's going to cost you absolutely nothing, effectively.
Try it out, test drive for 30 days,
Nice one. Nice one for sure.
Yeah,
okay. Okay. Well, as you said, time is getting on. We better let you get to sleep. But thanks a lot for coming over. I'm flummoxed now. I think we've sort of covered everything. What I'd like to do at the end of the show is just ground everybody here individually to see if there's anything else that they haven't mentioned yet that's exciting them in the past week or the coming up week or months for that matter. And any last minute thoughts from each of our panelists? I will start with Maria. Any final thoughts or?
Well, I'm reviewing more headsets. I'm reviewing the Shine Con this week, and it's going to see if anything else comes in the mail. I've got a whole bunch more ordered, so hopefully I'll be having more headsets to review. It's a lot of fun, and what else? Oh, I'm going to do another survey. The survey is a Hypergrid survey. Where do you go to get your Hypergrid avatar kitted out if you're new to the Hypergrid? Where do you start?
And so
I've been meaning to put that up. I'll put that up this week, and I'll give away a viewer to a random person who contributes a destination.
Very good. This is a potluck thing, you know. I can just imagine sort of, you know, I don't know about your cupboard full of headgear, but I can imagine sort of very, very large bucket with them all in it, where you close your eyes and you dip in.
So actually,
this one's the prize.
Yeah. I actually gave the winner a choice of which one she wanted last time. I probably will do that again because, you know, you want one that fits their phone. So,
yeah, exactly.
And you want one they like, so might as well. And I have a lot of them to choose from, so doesn't cost me anything to have them choose it, and they get one that they want to try.
Yeah, no, fair enough. Even better, in fact. Okay, wonderful. Well, James, any comments, last minute thoughts?
Well, actually, I do have something this week. I forgot where I saw it first. I saw it by an avatar on a blog, but it's the Atlantic Monthly magazine has an article online called "When a Video Game World Ends." And it chronicles basically three large MMO games. But I thought it was particularly cogent to OpenSim because, you know, it talks a lot about the emotions when these games ended and people had investments in the objects and the characters and the worlds. And to me, that's one of the big things about OpenSim. What you know, is really inspirational to me is that we can lose a world, we can lose a grid, but we don't lose the whole thing. And I think... I don't know. It just felt very poignant to me.
I did. I did see that also. In fact, I think I read most of it. I mean, I've seen similar articles before, and I had a conversation. I mean, an on-air conversation with Tara at some point. I'm sure on one of our earlier shows about. You know, she was, I think she called herself a chat cop in, was it Apple's Talk City way back when? It wasn't a virtual world, it was, you know, an online community though. And, you know, how communities have evolved over a period of time, you know, when Talk City closed. some whole chunks of the community just ported to other places. And indeed, in the days when I first, was in Second Life, I came in through a group of people who were beta testing Twitter. Before Twitter was public, really, and had meetings there and things like that. But basically, I came across a lot of other groups that really had been communities long before Second Life, and they had simply realized that the Second Life was, a new state-of-the-art place to have your community, and had ported their community over there. And, there's in Chilbo, where we sort of live in Second Life, or I'm never there now except when we do next week's show. But that's a community sort of function there. And I mentioned earlier about how they had this portable embassy and things, but most of the people that arrived there came word of mouth and knew people that were there already. And there was this, almost a split at one point where, a lot of the people involved in that, people like Fleep 2, Chris Collins and stuff, moved on out to OpenSim, and some of the other people there did. Others wanted to stick with Second Life because they were sort of more than happy there. Which is fine. There was a sort of split there. But, imagine if Linden Labs, all their shares fall out from under them and they go under one day for who knows what reason. The great thing is that the hypergrid will still be around, and people are just, can slowly come over here and get used to it, and pretty much the same thing. And as you say, if we lose grids on the hypergrid, there's always more popping up. And, the hardest thing that happens is you simply have to, if it's your home grid that you lose, then you'll obviously have to find a new home on the hypergrid, but you'll still be on the same hypergrid, I think that is something, it's like a website goes down and it's your favorite website. It's not there anymore, but you've still got the whole damn web. Right. To find placement, and I think that is the key there. You're not, that is actually in many ways the problem with the walled gardens, the Second Life,
very much so.
Maybe even the Inworlds of this world, the most appalling thing with those, especially gamers who are vested in a particular platform, is if it goes, their world collapses, and they have to rebuild it and find a new home to replace it. That is the hardest part. But I think the nature of things like the hypergrid means that that is a less hard heartbreak, as it were, than it would be, if Second Life went, or World of Warcraft went, or something that you are totally into to the point of being oblivious to the alternatives.
Yep.
Outside world, actually.
That too.
Permanent mark on my butt from this chair, let me tell you.
Much the same with me. And I'm thinking of that news item I read earlier on about the guy who survived no distress in 48 hours continuous VR.
I want to go pee breaks on that one.
Yeah, that's
bottles piled beside his desk.
But it's somewhat more how should I say, optimistic to think that they actually put a real person in VR for 48 hours instead of just doing it with a mouse. we put mice in VR for 3 years and they're bouncing around quite happily.
ain't cross-eyed and buggy.
Yes, exactly. That should be fun to actually enter a virtual world and find a chimpanzee avatar that really was a chimpanzee and try and make communication with it, wouldn't it?
Are you okay, Mel? Is it getting late for you, Mel?
No. But
you want to talk about talking to monkeys now?
No, well, the U.S. military. U.S. military is known for talking with dolphins.
Stop drinking the water, Mel.
We're just. Just put some dolphins, some dolphins in the virtual world and have a bit of cross-cultural communication virtually. That would be the ideal, wouldn't
it? Anything funny stuffed in heads and back?
So, yeah, never mind. Yeah, anyway, thank you, James. I did see that article. And actually, yes, it's a whole other topic. We'll save for another week. Yeah. Leslie, even beyond Tangled with the Hunt and everything else, anything else that's been exciting you in RL, SL, or any, the RL Open Series? Anyway, coming up or in the past week or two?
Anybody knows anybody from Craft World? Please tell them to put hints in their items, because they're not going to be found. They're just not going to be found. You're talking about a whole region, you know? And, the expo's ready to roll, so anybody wants to come over and see, you can come and visit Genesis anytime, even though it's not quite done, but they invite people to come on over. No problem at all. We are semi-hyper-graded grid, so you can hyper-get over anytime you like.
Sure. And for those viewers who have got their finger on the teleport button, now what do they type in the map? It's a port.
tanglegrid.net://8002:expo-aisle.
Okay, but if they stop at Tangle Grid in the port, they will arrive safely on the grid anyways, I'm quite sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we have a gate taking them back to the Hypergate Station, and we call it, and that goes everywhere, so.
Yeah, great fun. Okay, so, a destination already. We'll probably end up bringing the safari over there to the new expo at some point. I don't know whether it's been in touch, but... we usually do, don't we?
Yeah,
fresh. I'm promising to help her. I'm promising to help her a bit with that at the moment, because Fuchsia and Wizard have sort of not available at the moment. So she's been running on her own for a couple of weeks. So it does a wonderful job anyway. And there is she's actually building a safari embassy downstairs here as well on the township sim, which incidentally will contain a lot of the content that was at the Open Sim Community Conference Expo. The long-term stuff, not the hunt from there or anything like that, but the displays and stuff like that that were put out for Safari at the conference will be here downstairs. So that'd be fun too. Okay, well, I think with that we can call it a wrap. I'd like to thank everybody who's here. Thank you as always to my co-presenter Maria Karolov. Thanks, Maria.
Thank you, Mal, for having me. Always a joy to be here.
And thanks to James Outloud for being here and filming at the same time. Thanks, James.
Oh yeah, you know, I enjoyed so much. And I'm Leslie, I'm going to go there right after this and turn on my hint. So I should be good.
I can see if you don't.
That's right.
Yeah, the first thing Leslie said to me was, why didn't you put one down? And I thought, I did, didn't I?
Yeah, you said, yeah, I'm going to put one in the cage. It's going to be a great adventure. And I'm looking and looking and looking. Nothing. Wait till I see that man again.
Yeah. You know, we're good at some things, but we're not all good at everything. Including reading complicated instructions that aren't complicated.
Oh, that aren't complicated. For crying out loud.
I was about to say that aren't complicated at all. just probably adulated or something stupid. Actually, when I'm downstairs building things, I do tend to drift away and get highly sort of infatuated with little things I'm doing, to the extent that, you know, I'll sit back a while later and think, oh, why did that take me half an hour? I should have done it in 5 minutes if I'd been focused. Right. Okay. So, of course, thanks to our special guest this week, Leslie Kling from Tangle Grid. Thank you, Leslie.
It's always fun being here. That's for sure.
Absolutely.
It's special.
That's what we want to be, special. We are special. Yes, we are. Okay, everybody. Well, I'm going to wish you all a very good morning, a very good afternoon, or a very good evening, and indeed, And particularly pertinent for me and Leslie, actually, a very good tomorrow, if it's come yet, depending on wherever and whenever you are. And we will return next week. We will be in Second Life next week over at Chilbo, and then we'll be back here as usual the week after. So we'll see you then. Bye for now.